Good morning. Step on a cord there and break my neck. Hope everybody's doing well this morning. It's a beautiful day to be in God's house. I hope you're ready to just worship the Lord together. If you're a guest, I want to say welcome, particularly if you're a first-time guest. This is your first time to be at First Baptist. We welcome you. You're our honored guest today. We'd love to know about your presence. If this is your first time with us and you received a bulletin, there's a little tab inside. If you wouldn't mind tearing that out, you can fill it out, put it in the out on the table, out in the foyer at the end of the service. Or if you didn't get a bulletin, there's a little tab there in the pew rack in front of you. But we'd love to know about you. At the end of the service, the pastor and I are going to be out in the foyer, and we'd love to meet you and welcome you to this service. Let's bow together in prayer, and then our praise team will lead us as we worship together this morning. Would you bow with me as we pray? Our Father, what an incredible privilege it is to be in this place at this time today to worship you. Lord, we love you. Our worship is out of that love. We want to show our love for you as we sing. We want to show our love to you as we pray. We want to show our love as we listen intently to the word. And Father, we want to show our love as we respond to how you're speaking to us through your word today. Lord, would you empower our pastor, give him a fresh anointing of your Holy Spirit. Lord, may every word that he speaks be a word from you. But Father, I pray if that happens, if truly he is your voice today, Lord, that we'll receive it as such. We'll realize that you are speaking to us this morning, not just a man, but you are speaking. And if you're speaking, you want us to respond. And I pray that we will do that, that every person will be able to say, I've been obedient to the voice of God today as he has spoken to me. Now, Father, we lift our voices in praise to you. Through Jesus Christ we worship and we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church family. My name's Josh. We're going to sing a couple songs. Would you please stand to your feet? We're going to sing about the love of God this morning. The love of God has awakened us from death. He's saved us. I want to sing.
You came and broke them down. You broke them down. And there was
John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever would believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. That's what we're going to sing about now. Come all you weary to sing.
Here in your love.
Come on, sing.
Oh, sing.
There's nothing.
Amen. You may be seated. We have a time of celebration this morning. One of our prayers is that God will always be calling people from within our congregation to serve Him, to give their life to Him, give their heart, but also give their life to Him. And this morning we've come to celebrate and to pray over and commission two couples that God has called. If you guys will come stand right here in front of me, we want to introduce these people to you. This is Aaron and Alicia. Aaron and Alicia grew up here in our church, involved in student ministry, college ministry, have served the Lord in a number of different ways through the years. They've been married about a year now. After getting married, they moved to Charleston, and they've been serving the Lord there. But both of them have been involved in missions many different ways through the years here at First Baptist, going on some short-term trips, some summer-long trips as well. And God has called them to give their lives to the Lord to serve. And so a little over a week away, they're going to be leaving and going for 7 weeks of preparation for giving service in South Asia. They'll be serving there for a couple of years, and so we want to pray for them that God would protect them over these next weeks. God would bless them as they begin to think about a language and learning a new language and being involved there. But we're so excited what God has done with them. This is Braden and Rachel Brewington. Braden is actually on our mission staff here. They have been involved in a lot of different missions, activities, and projects as well. In fact, they met on a mission trip from First Baptist. So those of you single people, you might want to remember that next time we're signing up for mission trips. They met on a mission trip. They've been married about a year as well. They're both in college, and they're taking some online courses. And they're going to leave in just a little over a week, and they're going to work with our mission partners in Guatemala. One of our partnerships in mission is churches in Guatemala. They're going there. They'll be living there with some missionaries, and will be serving for a couple of months to assist them. And we believe also during this time God's going to help them as they begin to pray long-term over what God has for them as well. I want to invite all of our deacons of the church, if you will, to come down front and to stand here to lay hands on these couples. So deacons, if you'll come on up to the front this morning. I'm sure there are also some others that are Connect group leaders that have taught some of these before. Invite you to come on down as well, family members, and maybe they're just somebody you're very close to this group and you want to come down as well. We invite you to come down front and gather around them as we pray over them this morning as well.
All right, any friends that want to come down, let the families get in here close. And y'all gather around them. Didn't call you up here just to look pretty, so get around them and let's lay hands on them and pray for them. here in just a moment. You know, there's some things we can't say that we'd like to be able to say, but if you kind of read between the lines, we need to pray as they're going to the place that they're going for security and safety and all of those things, and just ask the Lord to bless them. So let's pray for them right now. We've done this now. This is the fourth time this morning, so we've asked the entire church body to undergird them and to pray for them. Father, we do come before you right now, and we thank you for these two couples. Aaron and Alicia grew up here. This is church to them. They first learned that you love them and who Jesus is. They were saved here and baptized here, and they've been involved in every area of ministry here. Their families are here. This is church. And you've called them as a married couple now to go way out of the comfort zone. And I pray your protection over them. I pray that you would guide their steps. I pray, Lord, that you would give them some victory along the way so that they would be encouraged. I know they're going to a difficult part of the world, so I pray that you would give them some victory as they seek to lead people to Jesus. Bless them in every way. Lord, for Rachel and Braden, thank you for what you've done through them in our church. They've been a blessing to us already. Now, as they prepare to go to Guatemala, and then beyond Guatemala, believing that you have a lifetime of ministry and mission for them somewhere on planet Earth, I pray your hand to be upon them. Give them an exciting few months in Guatemala, and then prepare their hearts for what's next. Lord, I pray for these families, because it's easy for us to just generically pray that you would raise up some young adults to send around the world. But when it's our young adults, our family, our kids, and they're going to involve our grandkids, and this is our family that's going to these places, it takes on a different light. So I pray for the family members, parents, siblings, everyone who's going to have a heart for this. And Lord, as a church, as the body of Christ at First Baptist Hendersonville, we commit that we will regularly, faithfully, routinely, fervently pray your blessings and your protection on these two couples. We'll write their names in our prayer journals. We'll remember them in the morning when we pray. We'll remember them in the evening. We will pray regularly for your blessings on them. Now, Lord, as a church family, all morning long, we have sought to commission them to say, you are ours, you go in the name of Jesus, and we're going with you. We're going with our prayers, we're going with our monetary support, we're going to be there for you and with you every step of the way. Bless them, I pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all. Thank you.
feel your love fall from me.
Lies your flow, steal your love fall from me. You've been so, so good to me.
We are so grateful for your love. We are so grateful for Jesus Christ. In a always changing world, we always want to take a time to go to your never changing word. We pray for our pastor. Would you give him the words to speak? God, speak clearly to our hearts this morning. That all the things going on around us, that we would just take a minute to breathe, to lay it all down. And to focus on you and your word and what you have to say to us this morning. Thank you, Lord, for this time of singing, of praying together, of reading your word together. We look to you now. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I love this praise team. I love the way they lead us in worship. And I love listening to you worship, because you don't just watch somebody else worship, you worship. And I love that about you. It's good to see everybody. Just a few more days and kids will be back in most schools in Sumner County, the public schools anyway, and other schools will be following soon thereafter. So just another few days and we're at an exciting time of the year, and believe that God has some great things that he's going to do in us and for us and through us in the days ahead. Well, today we're starting a new study. So I invite you to take your Bible and find Philippians. If you've kind of got it worn out turning to Hebrews, you need to take that bookmark and put it over in Philippians, because we finished that study a couple of weeks ago. We're starting a new one. I love finishing books of the Bible. You know, you feel like you've accomplished something. You've read through every word of every verse of every chapter of that book, and it's a feeling like we've really learned something in the Lord. The amazing thing is we could start over and do it again, and God would have something fresh and new to say to us, because we never get everything out of it, and because our lives are not static, we're always in a different position and a place. God will just say something to you the next time you study that you didn't see this time. It's just an amazing thing about the power of God's Word. Well, today we're starting a study in the book of Philippians, and I was going to take today and talk about just the background a little bit. I don't have to do that. 2 weeks ago, Pastor Bruce on July the 11th preached a great sermon from the 16th chapter of Acts. If you didn't hear that, I encourage you to go back and listen to it. It'll help you understand how the book of Philippians came about, why this church at Philippi was there to start with. Just to capture it very quickly, he told you about a man and a message and a mission. The man came to Paul in a vision and said, the message was, come over to Macedonia and help us. Now, the gospel had never been to Europe. The gospel had always been in Asia, and in specifically the Middle East of Asia. And this was the first time that a door had opened, the opportunity had been given for the gospel to be taken to Europe. And from there, it spread across Europe. It spread like wildfire, but it started in Macedonia. Macedonia is what we know today as Greece. And so Paul and Silas went and spent time in several places, but one of the places was Philippi. Now, you and I know that as the second missionary journey of Paul. He had three that we talk about. There were other small things that he did interspersed, but there were three major movements that we call mission movements. The first one was by Paul and Barnabas, and they had taken a young man with them named John Mark. John Mark would later write the Gospel of Mark. But early on, he was a little immature, and something happened in the course of that time, and he decided to go home. Well, that agitated Paul, and he wasn't happy about it. And so when the time came for the second missionary journey, Paul and Barnabas were getting ready to go, and Barnabas said, let's take John Mark again. I think he's learned his lesson. And Paul said, no, you can burn me once, but not twice. I'm not taking him again. And so Paul and Barnabas had a little bit of a disagreement. Now, they were still brothers in Christ. They still loved each other. They just had a disagreement. And so they decided that they would each go their own way on their own missionary journey. So Barnabas took John Mark, and they went one way. And Paul took a man named Silas, and they went on the second missionary journey. And that's where the church at Philippi was established. Now, time has passed. They're not on the missionary journey anymore. Paul is getting a little older. Paul has been arrested. Now, you know, Paul spent a lot of time in and out of jail. You might call him a jailbird. He was arrested several times. He was in jail in Philippi. He was in jail in Jerusalem. He was in jail twice in Rome. And this is one of those times that he was in jail in Rome. This is the first time. The second time was near the end of his life. If you want to read what he wrote then, go read 2 Timothy. He wrote that letter to Timothy near the end of his life. It has that great passage that says, the time of my departure is at hand. I fought a good fight. I have finished my course. He knows that the end of his life is near. That was his second imprisonment. But during the first imprisonment, he has asked to be tried in Rome. He's a Roman citizen. So when he was tried in Jerusalem, he appealed his case to the emperor. So he's been taken to Rome, and he's in jail for a long period of time, a couple of years, awaiting his trial. He's going to be tried by Nero. Nero doesn't like Christians. Nero is going to blame Christians for everything that he can, and every problem that he has, he's going to say it's their fault. So he's probably not going to get a good hearing, but he's in jail waiting on that. Now, he is under what we call house arrest. That means that unlike Philippi when he was in a regular prison cell, or Jerusalem when he was in a regular prison cell, or even the last time in Rome, this time he was in jail, but he was not really in the same confines that you would think of a jail. It was more like house arrest. Now, what that means, according to the book of Acts, is that people could come see him. They could bring things to him. They could bring him a coat when the winter came. They could bring him more clothing. They could take his old clothing and go wash it for him so he would have clean clothes. Most of the prisoners wouldn't have that. They could bring food to him. They could bring him a book. If he wanted to read a book, they could bring it to him. They could bring him writing paper. Whatever he needed, they could come and go. Now, he couldn't come and go. He was under guard. He was in prison. But guests, visitors could come and see. So it was during that period of time that Paul wrote four letters that we call the prison epistles. Four of them. He wrote one letter to a group of churches in an area called Galatia. We call that book the book of Galatians. He wrote one book to the church at Ephesus. We call that the book of Ephesians. He wrote one book to an individual, a man named Philemon, and that's in the Bible by the name of Philemon. This book he wrote to the church at Philippi. Now, this is an unusual letter. Paul wrote 13 letters in all, and this is the most unusual of all of them. There's several reasons it's unusual. One is because he never quotes the Old Testament. And Paul always quoted the Old Testament. He was an expert in the Scripture. He always quoted it, but in this book, there's not one quote. The reason is because he wasn't writing to correct them about anything. He wasn't writing to fix a problem. He wasn't writing because of corruption. He wasn't writing because of a misunderstanding of theology. He wasn't dealing with a crisis. Every other book that he wrote, that's why he wrote it. He was trying to help somebody somewhere understand something that they misunderstood. He was dealing with a problem, with a crisis, with an issue, but not Philippians. Philippians, he just writes this book to tell these people that he loves them and to thank them for something that they have done for him. It's the most positive, upbeat letter that out of all of them that Paul wrote. Now, the Bible doesn't say this, and I'm just conjecturing here, but I believe that out of all the churches Paul ever had anything to do with, that he loved the church at Philippi more than any other. He just had a real love affair with these people. Now, here's what happened. When word got out that Paul was under arrest and had been sent to Rome, he's going to be tried by Nero, the churches were all concerned about that. So they started praying for him. Wednesday night prayer meeting, you better believe they had Paul on their prayer list. Their connect groups, they had Paul on their prayer list. Somebody would say at church every week, hey, let's pray for Paul. Don't forget about Paul. Paul's under house arrest. Everybody was praying for Paul. But the church at Philippi took it a step further. The church at Philippi said, we're not only going to pray for Paul, let's take up an offering. Let's get together some clothing. Let's get some books that we know that he would like to read. Let's get some money so that some food can be provided for him, because you know how bad that prison food is. Let's take up an offering and let's send this to Paul to help him. They're the only church that did that. Now, how did they get it to him? Once they collected it all, they're in Macedonia, that's in Greece. Paul's in Rome, that's in Italy. How did they get all of that to Paul? Did they send it UPS or FedEx or maybe PushPay or PayPal? What did they do? No, they couldn't do any of those things. They used a courier. I wonder at the business meeting when they decided who was going to get the privilege of taking this to Paul, I wonder how many hands went up and said, ooh, 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 me, I want to do that. Let me take that to Paul. I'd love to take, to be able to sit down with the Apostle Paul to take this gift to him. I volunteer. I want to do that. I'll take vacation from work. Let me do it. I don't know how they picked the person, but they came up with a man named Epaphroditus. It's an unusual name to us. It was a common name to them. They chose Epaphroditus to take this special offering, to go as their envoy from the church at Philippi to take this offering to Paul. When they got there, when Epaphroditus got there, Paul was so appreciative. He was going to send Epaphroditus right back, but Epaphroditus got sick. As a matter of fact, he got so sick he almost died. after he got well, Paul sent him home with a thank you letter. Now, how do I know all that? How do I know that about Epaphroditus? Well, let me show you before we read what we're going to read today. Look in chapter 2, down in verse 25. Philippians 2:25. But I considered it necessary to send you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier, as well as your messenger and minister to my needs, since he has been longing for all of you and was distressed because you heard that he was sick. Indeed, he was so sick, he nearly died. Look over in chapter 4 at verse 18. But I've received everything in full, and I have an abundance. I'm fully supplied, having received from Epaphroditus what you provided, a fragrant offering, a welcome sacrifice, pleasing to God. So Paul is writing this letter. It's unique from all of the letters in the New Testament. He's writing this letter not to fix a problem, not to correct anybody, not to deal with some theological issue. He's writing this letter to say thank you to a group of people that he loves very, very much. Now, I'm going to call this the joy letter because 18 times in this book, it'll begin next week when we get to verse 4. We won't get that far today. But when we get to verse 4, you're going to see for the first time the word joy, J-O-Y. Now, if you start marking them down and counting them, you will find joy or joyful or joyous, some form of that word joy. You'll find that word 18 times in this book. So I'm calling it the joy letter. Let's begin by reading just two verses. I think that's all we really have time to deal with this morning. It says, Paul and Timothy, slaves of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, including the overseers and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, there are three things I want you to see in that this morning. Pretty simple, but it's where we start. Number one, I want you to see the writer. He tells us who this book is from. Now, you know, they had a different way of writing letters than we do, and I think their way's better. When we write a letter, this is what we do. We put a salutation. So we say, Dear Mama. Now, if you're not Mama, don't read this letter, right? This is who it's to. I'm writing this letter to Jane or John or whoever it is, dear so-and-so. Then we put the body of the letter. We say what we're going to say to them. Then we finish it up, and at the very end, we sign our name. Now, I get some letters sometime, to be honest with you. They're typed out. There's no return address. I don't know who it's from. I've got to skip over to page 2 or 3 or 5 or 10, however how long they wrote. I've got to go all the way to the end to figure out who wrote this. And who wrote it is going to impact the way I'm reading this. They had a much better way. They didn't start that way. They started by saying who it's from. Hey, I want you to know who this letter is from. So they tell us who it's from, and then there's the body of the letter, and then at the end they sign it. So their name's on the front end of it and their name's on the back end of it. Well, look at who he says sends this letter. Paul and Timothy. Did you notice that before? Not just Paul. Why do we say Paul wrote this letter when it clearly says Paul and Timothy? Is that unique? Is that unusual? Not really. If you go to 1 Thessalonians, it says the same thing, Paul and Timothy. If you look at 2 Thessalonians, same thing. 2 Corinthians, same thing. Philemon, same thing. Colossians, same thing. Six times out of the 13 books that he wrote, six times it says Paul and Timothy. What does that mean? Well, Timothy was Paul's protege. Paul was his mentor. Paul was training him in the ministry. He was teaching him things. So when Paul was sent to Rome under arrest, Timothy made his way there. And now Timothy is in Rome to try to help Paul. He's there for Paul. If Paul needs something, Timothy goes and gets it. Timothy makes sure he has food every day so that he won't starve with that bad prison food. If it turns cold, Timothy makes sure that he has warm clothing to wear. Whatever Paul needs, Timothy is there to help him with that. Now, I believe that this more accurately should say, rather than Paul and Timothy, it probably should say Paul with Timothy. Because what Timothy is doing really is just, he's the scribe. He's writing down what Paul says. When you read all of Paul's letters, several times he says, at the very end, he says, see that I'm signing this in my own handwriting. What that means is that he didn't write the rest of it in his own handwriting. Somebody else did. So Paul probably was dictating these letters. He was speaking them. Timothy is writing them down, and then Paul signs it at the end to authenticate. They would recognize his signature. You recognize the signature of people that you know. They would recognize his signature, and they would know that indeed it was from the Apostle Paul. So Paul says, from me and Timothy, because Timothy was his scribe. Look at what else it says. Paul and Timothy, slaves of Christ Jesus. You need to understand, I know we don't like the word slave. It's a bad word. We know slavery was wrong. It's a blight upon our culture, world. Slavery is not a good thing. But this is not talking about physical slavery. This is talking about spiritual slavery. They were spiritual slaves. And this is what you need to understand about that. Every person in this room, listen to me. Give me 30 seconds and tune in. Every person in this room is either a slave to Jesus Christ or you are a slave to sin. Now you may say, I don't like that terminology, preacher. I don't agree with that. Well, take that up with Jesus, because that's what he said in John chapter 8, verse 34. I assure you, these are his words, I assure you, everyone who commits sin is a slave of sin. You are either a slave to sin or you are a slave to Jesus. Did you know back in the book of Exodus that there were times that people were freed from their slavery? There were benevolent slave owners, kind people who decided way before Abraham Lincoln knew anything about the Emancipation Proclamation, who decided to set their slaves free. And Exodus 21 says that many times the slave would decide they did not want to stop working for their who had been their master, who would now be their boss. And they would say to them, you've been kind to me. You've cared for me and my family. You've been there for us. We don't want to leave you. We will voluntarily stay and work with you. Exodus 21 said that when that happened, they would take the person and take their ear and put it on the doorpost of a house. And then they would take a special tool and a hammer, and they would drive that tool through the ear of that person, marking them as someone who could have been set free, but they've chosen to stay and work for this person. You see people these days that have these big old things and these big old holes in their ears. I don't mean for earrings like you ladies have pierced ears. I mean big old holes. There's nothing new under the sun. That goes all the way back to Exodus 21. They were driving holes in the ears to mark them as bond servants. You and I ought to be marked. I don't mean you need somebody to drive a tool through the earlobe on your ear, but I'm saying the way we talk, the way we act, the way we live, the way we treat people, the way we conduct ourselves, there ought to be something in our life that marks us as followers of Jesus Christ. Paul and Timothy, he says, slaves of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the writers. Let's look at the readers. Who's it to? Look at the last part of verse 1. Now, I want you to notice there's a geographical designation. That's pretty easy to see. But there's also a spiritual designation. To all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, including the overseers and deacons. Let me just give you a word about that last statement. That doesn't have anything to do with what I'm about to say, but it's important to know. When you're reading in the New Testament and you come across the word bishop or elder or overseer or pastor, all four of those words mean exactly the same thing. They're interchangeable. Overseer, bishop, elder, pastor. They all mean the same thing. Those are the people that God has put to lead that local body of believers. Then he uses the word deacon, those who have been set apart to serve, so that the pastors can be free to pastor, the deacons do the taking care of the needs of the people. But now look at what he says about to whom this letter is written. There's a geographical designation. He says to the church at Philippi. That's their zip code. That's where they live. If he were writing it to us, he would say to the church in Hendersonville at First Baptist. That's our designation. So it's a geographical statement. But there's a spiritual statement. Did you see that? He says to all the saints. Let me ask you a question. I've asked this all morning long. Let me ask it to you. How many of you would say, I am a saint? I am a saint. Now, I don't see but a couple of hands, and they were halfway. They weren't quite sure if they really wanted to give it or not, but it was kind of one of these. Let me ask it this way. How many of you would say, without any embarrassment. I publicly state that I have chosen to be a follower of Jesus Christ. I'm saved not because of what I do, but because of what He did for me. He died on the cross in my place, and I am a follower of Jesus Christ. Almost every hand in here. Well, you should have raised your hand the first time. We've let somebody take a very good biblical term and make it mean something that it never meant. See, we have taken the word saint to mean somebody that lives such a holy life. They are so good that at some point they just get elevated to this position of sainthood, and none of us can ever achieve that. That is not biblical. That is not biblical. That is a man-made concept, and we ought to reject that fully. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, you are a saint. A saint means to be set apart. Saint doesn't have to do it with your behavior as much as it has to do with your position. We are in Christ. Now, when we are in Christ, He cares about our behavior, and He wants our behavior. He doesn't leave us like we were, but we're saved not because we got our behavior fixed. We're saved because of His grace and the work that He did in our lives. We are saints. Now, I told you a minute ago to tune in, and some of you did, and then you tuned right back out. So tune in again. Give me about 60 seconds here, and then you can go back to La La Land, but give me about 60 seconds. Everybody listen. I want everybody to hear this. There are two kinds of people in this world. There are the saints, and I'm not talking about the football team in New Orleans. I'm talking about those who have followed Jesus Christ as Lord of life. There are the saints, and there are the ain'ts. There are only two groups. You're one or the other. When Bruce preached that message 2 weeks ago out of Acts 16, he told you about three people in that chapter that Paul met at Philippi. He told you about a woman named Lydia. She was an aint. She was very religious. She was very religious, but she had never come to meet Jesus. She didn't know who He was. She was an aint. He told you about a girl who was telling the future, a fortune teller with a demon possession. She was an aint. He told you about a jailer who was going to kill himself because he thought all of the prisoners were going to escape. He was an aint. But in Acts chapter 16, all three of those people went from being aints to being saints because they came to faith in Jesus Christ. That's to whom this book is written, to all the saints. You are a saint. When I was a kid, here's what we played as boys in the neighborhood. We played either sports games, which was predominant. We played football and basketball and baseball. We didn't know anything about soccer. You all play soccer now. We didn't know anything about soccer in those days. But the pretend games that we played, girls had pretend games they played. We had pretend games that we played. We played Cowboys and Indians, and Army. Now, when you were playing Army, we'd divide up into teams, and we'd hide in these woods, and we'd kind of sneak around, and sometimes we had little dart guns, and, you know, nowadays you have paintball guns and really cool things to use. We didn't have all that, so we'd just have to kind of get the lowdown on somebody and get up behind them, and we'd say, bang, and they were dead. Now, once they were dead, they had to lay down and play dead. Now, if you got killed early in the round, and we did this in rounds, and, you know, once that one was over, we'd start over and do it again, and everybody got to come back to life and hit a reset button, and we started over. If you got killed early in the round, and it just kind of went on and on, you'd get tired of laying there. And so you'd find yourself sitting up, and then you'd find yourself standing up, and then you'd find yourself walking around, and invariably somebody would come up and say, if you're dead, act like it. Don't be walking around when you're dead. You're confusing everybody. You look like you're alive. If you're dead, be dead. Well, I've got news for you as a follower of Jesus Christ. If you are a follower of His, act like it. Stop saying that you're a follower of Jesus Christ and acting like everybody else acts. Talking like everybody else talks. Living like everybody else lives. If you're an ain't, live like an ain't, but if you're a saint, live like a saint. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, your life should be different. Now, there's a third thing I want you to see. I'll show it to you quickly. It's in verse 2. I showed you the writer. I showed you the readers. Think for just a minute about the most important part of all of it. I told you the word joy is found 18 times. There's another word found 10 times. It's the word mind. Let this mind be in you, that He'll guard your hearts and your minds. It's a very important word in the book of Philippians, probably the second most important word behind joy. But here's a word that's used over 40 times. That is what this book is about. I read two verses and he already said it three times. Look at what he said. You'll see it. Paul and Timothy, slaves of, here it is, Christ Jesus. To all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, including the overseers and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. This book is about Jesus. He is our Savior. It's the writer, it's the reader, it's the Savior. He is our Savior. And as I go through this book week after week, I do not want to lose sight of the fact this book is not about Paul loving these people. This book is not about what good things they did for him. This book is not just about benevolence and fellowship. This book is about Jesus Christ and the difference that Jesus Christ makes in a person's life. And you don't need anything as much as you need a relationship with Jesus Christ. Now there are three words that are mentioned, two of them in verse 2, one's going to come up in verse 4. I want you to see it. This tells us what a relationship with Jesus Christ does. Look in verse 2, there's the word grace. You see it? Grace. If you know someone named Karen or charis, that word is the Greek word for grace. Grace is what God does for us that we don't deserve. I don't deserve God's forgiveness. I don't deserve my sin to be forgiven. I don't deserve heaven. I don't deserve any of those things. God's grace is giving us what we don't deserve. Now, God's mercy is withholding what we do deserve. I deserve hell. I deserve death. I deserve the grave. God withholds what we do deserve, and he gives us what we don't deserve. So there's the word grace. Second, look at the word peace. The word peace, if you know anybody named Irene, that's kind of an older name. You don't hear babies being named Irene these days, although some old names are becoming popular again. But Irene is a name that means peace. Let me show you. Let me kind of give you a visual. Look at me. Let me give you a visual of what the word peace means. Here's God. God is holy and just and perfect. And here we are. We're sinners. And we've been separated from God. We are at division with God. What God does is to bring us together with himself and give us a relationship. That's peace. That's what that word means. He puts something that is broken back together. Now look in verse 4, and there's the triplet of these sisters, grace and peace. In verse 4 is the word joy. If you know anybody named Kara, that is the Greek word, Kara. It means joy. And here's what I want you to know. Everybody in this world wants joy. I want to be joyful. I want to have joy in my life. Joy always comes after grace and peace. Always. Look anywhere in the Bible, joy always follows grace and peace. What that means is the only way you can truly have joy in your life is to experience grace and peace. Now, do you think we ought to take Paul's word on this? I mean, maybe he lived in an ivory palace, you know. Maybe he had everything, never had any problems, plenty of money, didn't deal with real life situations like me and you. You know, can we trust him on this? You know, I think there's some books that people could write that I don't think I'd read it because I don't think they know what they're talking about. If Charles Barkley wrote a book on how to play golf, I'm not going to buy that book. Charles Barkley, his golf swing is horrible. He's gotten a little better, but it's still horrible. But if Charles Barkley wrote a book on how to play basketball or how to be a entertaining, funny, common tater or to call people knucklehead, I'd buy that book because he knows how to do those things. He's really good at that. Should we take Paul's word for this? Oh, yeah. Remember back in Acts 16 when he was in jail? They thought they were going to be killed. What'd they do? Sit around and complain and bellyache and talk about how bad they'd been treated? No, they just started singing some hymns to the Lord. Bruce talked 2 weeks ago about your song in the night. What's your song in the night? That was a gripping statement, Bruce. What's your song in the night? I think Paul knows what he's talking about. Let me tell you something, and I'll be done. We talk a lot about being happy. Happiness is based on what happens around us. If you came to church today and you got a flat tire in your car, the car wouldn't start, or you had a wreck, you're not very happy. If you get sick, you're not very happy. If you lose your job, you're not very happy. If you have a relationship problem, that doesn't make you happy. Happiness is based on the external things around us. Joy is what's in your heart. So even when Paul was in prison, happy about that? I doubt it. But even in prison, the joy of the Lord was his strength. The only way you can have that joy is to experience grace and peace. And that comes in a relationship with Jesus. I'm going to tell you that over and over and over and over again. Because no matter what else is said, that's really the heart of it. It starts and ends right there. Let me pray for you. Lord, I pray for someone today. All morning we've had people who've publicly professed faith. They've been saved today. Thank you. I pray for that teenager that's been wrestling with something that they heard at camp, that middle schooler. You've been working in their mind, their heart. I pray for that child that went to Bible school or kids camp and they've been wrestling with this. I pray for an adult, even a grandparent that's never come to a point of personal faith. And life is just a roller coaster. Sometimes we're happy and sometimes we're upset, and everything's just determined by what's going on around us. And yet there are people that we know that no matter what happens, they still seem to have joy. I pray for that person that needs to come today to understand that it all begins and ends in a relationship with Jesus Christ. There's no substitute. There's no magic formula. It's just knowing Jesus. I pray that even right now someone would open their heart and say, Lord, I invite you to do in me what only you can do. I want to experience joy. And to do it, I have to experience grace and peace. I pray, Lord, that the Spirit would sweep this place, that you would do your work right now. In Jesus' name, amen. The altar's open. Pastor Bruce and I are here. We'd love to talk with you, help you, point you in the right direction, any way we can. Let's stand together while we sing.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean, singing how marvelous. Shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
He took my sin.
He took my sin and my sorrow, and he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. Singing how marvelous, how love for me.
What a wonderful beginning to the book of Philippians. It's going to be a great study over these next months. If you have a spiritual decision to make, the pastor and I, some other staff, we're going to be out in the foyer at the end of the service, invite you to come by. We would be so honored to visit with you and to pray with you. If you're a guest, please come by. Let us meet you and thank you for being here today. I pray you have a wonderful week. May you go in God's peace. You're dismissed. Thank you.